Now that I've shown you a lower bound for sorting, let's try to break it. And that sounds like a contradiction. But in a sense, we can do this here. The answer is it's not always necessary to take n log n time. We can't do with less than n log n comparisons if we're living in the comparison model. But we don't have to live in the comparison model if we choose not to. It's a definition, if you like. And that's another way to see lower bounds. Lower bounds are great because they're a strong statement about impossibility. No comparison-based sorting algorithm can be better than n log n comparisons. But it's also a pointer to where you can change the model so that faster algorithms become possible. And here's one specific model that I want to look at with you that's outside of the comparison-based model. And that's if we sort numbers. And to make life easy, we assume it's integers, no real numbers where we have to argue how to represent them in a computer. But with integers, we already know we have a sound model, the word RAM model, which tells us how we can store integers in a computer. It's a binary number, and we assume the integers that we're dealing with have a certain number of digits at most. So suppose we are looking to sort integers instead of some black box objects that we can't look into. Then formally, the first statement is our lower bound for applied. We can do a lot more with integers than comparing them. I mean, we can add them up, we can compute averages, we can compute arbitrarily complicated functions about numbers. The question is, how much does this help for sorting? If you think about it for a moment, it might not help that much. But it turns out it's enough to beat this lower bound for comparison-based sorting. Now let's walk through this slowly, because the detailed assumptions are important here. First of all, I have to fix a certain range for the numbers that I'm sorting. Now, any specific input that you have will have integers from a certain range, from the smallest to the largest number that you're given. But here, I'm restricting a priority. I only want to sort numbers that are between 0 and u minus 1. And we'll usually assume that u is a power of 2, because then we can argue, we can say the numbers are b-bit integers. Okay? If we have these b-bit integers, and b is not too big, if the number of bits that I need to represent a single integer is less than w, the word size of my machine, then I can fit one integer in one word of the computer registers and memory cells. Okay? That's a reasonable assumption. It would today mean we can sort integers up to 2 to the 64 or 63. And that's plenty for many applications. So it's reasonable to assume this. And it occurs often enough. Then there's a simple way how we can sort those numbers in essentially linear time. The time will be linear in n and u. And the space will also be proportional to u. Now, if u is 2 to the 64, that's a lot. I'm not good enough to compute this. I should have pre-computed it. It's a lot of main memory. We won't have enough to do this. If u is just 2 to the 32, it's around 4 gigabytes. So we can do that. It's not that much. So it depends a bit how big u really is. But suppose it's small enough so that we can afford u memory cells on our machine. And in the in theory land, where we work on this word RAM model, we'll just assume we have enough memory because the memory is actually unbounded. Then we can do the following. We use an integer array of the size of the universe, and we just count how often each number occurs. So we walk through our input list, then we use the number of the input list as an address in this count array. That's another thing we can do with numbers that we can't do with arbitrary objects. We can use numbers as an offset in an array. And that's something that makes sorting really easier. Okay, so this is just increment that cell. So that does nothing more than count the number of occurrences of all possible integers in our range. And once we have the counts, we can just write out the sorted list by producing an appropriate number of copies of each number. That's it. Okay, simple algorithm. Do you have questions about the algorithm? Again, as I said, it depends a lot on you if this is a reasonable method to go for or not. If U is 2 to the 64, forget it. If U is 2 to the 32, it's expensive but might be feasible. And if U is a good bit smaller than that, go for it, because it will probably be faster than any comparison-based method. So in particular, Java uses essentially this method for sorting byte arrays. So a byte is just 8 bits, 2 to the 8. And then the count array is really small. There's also character arrays. Now, I'm not sure what Java uses for that. At the top of my head, I would guess they don't use counting sort because it's a little too much memory for a standard library. But if you wanted to sort a character array really fast, that's 16 bits each, that's also still doable. Okay, long story, short message. We can sort in linear time if what we're sorting is special, if that's integers from a range that's essentially the size of our input array, then we can do it in linear time and linear space, which is actually a drag, but okay. We beat the lower bound by escaping the model of the lower bound. I wanted to briefly add a theory slide on the latest and greatest on sorting integers. So this is not relevant for the exam, but in case you're interested, the first part is actually elementary. You can still sort in linear time. So the previous slide said if the universe is linear in the size of the array, if the universe is polynomial in the size of the array, you can essentially do the same by a couple of rounds of radix sort. If that doesn't mean anything to you, don't worry. We won't need this here. All we need for the rest of the lecture is essentially counting sort in the basic form I've shown it to you. And then you can go a little more into the theory regime. What if we set universe size to be precisely this, the size of integers that fit into our word of the word RAM. And we allow W to be a function of N. Now, I said in unit one, we will usually, so unit one said we just assume W is essentially log N up to some constant. Now here I'm saying, suppose W is some function in N, and I want a sorting method that works well for any range. Then it turns out if W is fairly small, like in this case, we can actually sort in linear time using the methods I've just shown you. And also, if W is very big, if the integers you're sorting are very long, also your machine is very powerful because it can handle these very long integers in constant time. Then again, you can sort in linear time, but with a completely different method, completely different algorithm. And for W in between, it's an open problem that kept bugging theorists for decades, whether or not you can sort in linear time. You might or might not care, but at least the n square root of log log n randomized algorithms might be a hint that this is some really fancy stuff going on. And some of these, so this algorithm is complicated and won't perform well on reasonably sized inputs, but there's simpler methods that live in this range in between that are not quite as efficient asymptotically that do perform well. So if you're sorting lots of big integers, it might actually be possible to apply fancy cutting-edge research techniques to that. But don't worry for the rest of this class, so this is not, it's for your curiosity. That's what I wanted to say on integer sorting. For the rest of the unit on sorting here, we'll talk about parallel sorting, and we'll go back to the comparison-based model, because it's the more general way of sorting. It's more typical in applications to sort objects than plain integers. So this was a little excursion that shows you, one, every lower bound comes with a model, and if you leave the model, lower bound might not hold, and you might be able to beat it. And takeaway two is specifically counting sort. If I have integers from a range roughly the size of my array, I can sort them in linear time.